from Rice University, home of the world's most bored parking enforcement officers. It's General Physics 2. Today, Physical Optics, featuring Young's Double Slit and Thin Films. Dr. Stenson. Also, a dangerous demonstration. And now, a man who thought increasing the size of the student body was a reference to COVID weight. Professor Hafner.
Please stop, please, please. You're embarrassing yourself. All right, welcome to your the highlight of your week. Promoting Dr. Stenson. And two panelists. Telling you, two panelists. This is too much. All right, so let's see, what are we doing? Today we are gonna finish up beats. Right, we kind of talked about beats a little bit last time, a little more detail. And then we're gonna talk more about interference, but specific kinds of interference we talk about with light. So light is a wave. We've talked a little bit about light and what it does in a dielectric. Now we're gonna talk about how it interferes. And you could say it'd be the same as sound, right? And in a way it's the same as sound, but there's certain kinds of problems we do, certain approximations we make that are specific to light. So that's what we're gonna do. I think we're more or less on schedule to do rest of interference and diffraction this week and to do geometric optics next week and then a review week for the exam on that Friday. One thing about the homeworks, I was renumbering them to call them like P1, P2. That means pandemic year one, pandemic year two. But now they're getting way too mixed up. We're jumping around. So they're just gonna have the old Canvas homework numbers on them. Don't worry, if it looks like they don't make sense, those are the ones I chose to look just for you. I was just thinking about you personally when I chose those, so. Okay, I'll ask Annie to adjust one thing over here, sorry. As much as I'd like to see a big smiling Dr. Stenson, I do need to be able to see what I'm writing on the board, so I'm gonna switch it over to me. I will print that picture of Dr. Stenson and put it on the wall somewhere else, so. Okay, here we go. So we were talking about beats. Oh, and there's also just FYI, there's a whole whopping, oh, okay, there's a lot of people here. Is we talked about how, you know, in interference, originally we were saying it's two waves, same wavelength, same frequency. Let's just think about how they add constructively and destructively as they go in and out of phase for various reasons. We said, but let's also think a little bit about what if we have a different frequency, let's say omega, well, I don't know, look like a formula. Let's just say frequency. This part is a little bit review. We said this before. For example, if we had two waves, D1, one is A sine K1X minus omega 1T, and the other one is, it could be the same amplitude. It can also be a sine in phase, fine, but it's 2K2 minus omega 2T. What if we superpose those two waves? What's it gonna look like? So the problem is this one, it's, when you do it mathematically, it's hard to see any insight because you just get it from a trig identity. So let's just apply the trig identity and then we will search for the insight. So if you're gonna combine two sines, sinusoids with different things in the argument, right? That's harder to combine. So we're gonna do it. Oh, one thing we're gonna do is say at x equals zero. Just because really both the time and the space are causing beats, but we just, let's just look at one at a time. Okay. So let's say what's happening at the origin between these two waves. That way we can just call this sine of minus omega t. Anyway, when you combine those at x equals zero, D1 plus two is twice the amplitude, that makes sense. And instead of the sum of two sines, it becomes the product of two sines. And since we often do these for homework problems, we'll recast it in terms of frequency F instead of omega. And I usually think about the world in F when you do theory with omega. So it's the product of two sinusoids, but the frequencies are neither omega 1 nor omega 2. It's actually 2 pi, this is omega, but 2 pi F average is the average frequency in one sinusoid, and 2 pi times 1/2 the difference frequency in the other sinusoid. Okay, now, why would I write 2 pi times 1/2? Because I'm trying to remind you, this is 2 pi times a frequency, so this whole thing really is omega, right? But it's 2 pi and it's 1/2 the difference. It's not exactly the difference, it's 1/2 the difference. Why? Because that's what the trig identity says, okay? There's also 1/2 here, but it's 1/2 times the sum. And what is 1/2 times the sum? The average, right? That's what we're trying to make this sort of phenomenological or something, you know, related to problems. So realize that average also has 1/2 in it. If you need it to be symmetric because you love math, it's 2 pi times 1/2 the sum, 2 pi times 1/2 the difference. Just 1/2 the sum happens to be the average. Okay, so what are we gonna get out of that? So, I mean, nothing. It's the product of two sinusoids. But there is a little something we can get out of it. If what we do now, let's do two things. Let's just plot it first. Okay, let's, what does that look like? Let's plot D1 plus 2 at x equals 0 as a function of time. We could have also said, let's look at the shape at time equals 0 for all x. It would come out basically the same. That negative sign goes away. But what we got here is a fast frequency here. Because let's imagine these are both high frequencies, you know, omega 1, omega 2, 800 hertz in your ear, you know, something high. So when you take the average of two high frequencies that are close to each other, then the average is a high frequency, right? It's just right in between them. This is slow. If you imagine these are high frequencies close to each other, say 800 hertz and 802 hertz, then the difference is 2 hertz, which is very slow. Right? You can't even hear that. Is D1, 2 sine, then cosine? I think they're both. Oh, no, you're right. It's sine, cosine. Yeah, that's from last week. Sorry. I just copied out of a note wrong. I mean, it doesn't really matter. You'll see why in a minute. That means I have to start this at 0. Okay, fine. I have no idea what I was saying. Yes, okay, fast frequency, slow frequency. So if we plot it, what you can eventually realize is it's a fast frequency being modified by a slow frequency. That's what a plot would look like. So here you can see F average is like this fast thing, and F difference is modulating the thing. That. Now, is this correct? No, I drew this for a sine here. Oh, I'm sorry. I don't want to redraw it. Right. All I'm saying is I should have started here, right? Because the modulator is cosine. So you'll live. But the point is, it's a fast frequency modulated by this slow frequency. So I'll call this F difference. All right. Now, and that's why when you listen to it, that's why it's called beats. If we did 800 hertz and 802 hertz, it'd go woo, 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 and you can hear it beat, 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 beat. And the beat that you hear is the difference in the frequency. We'll get to that in a minute, exactly why. I can actually give you a little bit of an intuition of why this happens without having to just say, oh, it's a trig identity. And we can do that by plotting D1 and D2 at slightly different frequencies. So here we go. This really is gonna test my artistic abilities here. I have a beautiful animation of this, but I couldn't find it. So, okay. Let's plot a sinusoid here. At one frequency, and I'm gonna plot another high frequency sinusoid at a slightly different frequency. right? And now we want to think about is how are these going to superpose, if I may use that word. So if you looked at them, you'd say, well, that's, what do we call that? Constructive, isn't it? Oh. Constructive right there. We got a peak over a peak. 1 + 1 = 2. You're good at that. Now, what if, though, the peaks aren't going to stay over the peaks because they're different frequencies? So if we move down thing, what's going on here? Uh-oh. This doesn't look good. What kind of interference is that? Destructive. All right. Let's move on down. The destructive, kind of in between. Uh-oh. What kind of interference is that? It's negative, but it's constructive, isn't it? Yeah, so you can imagine if you did this, it's just two sinusoids at different frequency just kind of drift in and out of phase. And how quickly do they drift in and out of phase? Well, if their frequencies are really close, then really slowly, right? That's why the beat is slow, but the average is fast, right? So here, this would look like, in this pattern, this is here, and this is destructive, and then this is constructive again, like that. Pretty cool. Beats. Gotta love them. Here, let's listen to some beats while I do something else.
Now I really want to get this beat pattern in your head, like we got the other case of superposition in your head. So it's similar setup. We have a function generator driving a couple of speakers. The speakers make sound waves that oscillate your tympanic membrane, which you hear as sound. Now we're going to have the speakers going at slightly different frequencies. So now each one has its own function generator. They're both set at 320 hertz. So if I turn one up, you can hear a nice 320 hertz. And if I turn the other one, also 320 hertz. Now, what gets interesting is when I now drive them at different frequencies. So I'm going to knock this one up to 321 hertz. So you can kind of hear the beat. Right, it gets loud and then it gets quiet, loud and quiet. It's going from having the two sinusoids add to having the two sinusoids cancel. The beat period should come out to be the difference in frequency. So here I have a difference of 1 hertz, 321 and 320, and you can hear it isn't about 1 hertz. If you check it on your little YouTube clock, it's about 1 hertz. If I go to a 2 hertz difference, the beat period is, the beat frequency is twice as fast. And sure enough, it sounds like about 2 hertz, right? Right, if I go to 3 hertz difference, three times, it's about a 3 hertz beat, and it'll always be the difference, right, according to the formula. There is a, oh, what are we up to, 20, there's 12 hertz. And then it starts to make horrible sounds. You can turn the amplitudes up, and all kinds of horrible things can happen. So now you've felt the beat in your own head. Why don't we turn this off and move on?
Enchanting. Okay, so it really does happen. It's what you hear when things sound out of tune. If you were in band and two people were out of tune, if they were barely out of tune, it went wah, 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 wah. One interesting thing to notice is, I'll just write it as a sentence. Beats are modulated at 1/2 the frequency of the difference. Remember, that was in our formula. We didn't have a half on the average because that's what the average naturally has, a half in it, but the difference doesn't have a half in it, right? The difference between 800 and 802 is 2. You don't need a half. But then in that demo, you fairly clearly heard, the audio gets really modulated by Zoom, but usually sounds better, but it's pretty clear that the beat was happening at the difference in frequency. You couldn't see the decimal point, but those were differences of like 1 hertz and 2 hertz. So why didn't the half show up? And the reason is, so they're modulated at half, but you hear two beats per cycle. Right, so we draw that beat frequency again. I'll draw it incorrectly again. So look at that. You're going to hear that as wah wah, two beats, but the modulation is like this. And that's the modulating low frequency. So this frequency is at 1/2 F difference. Whoops. Now, when I labeled it before, I think I pointed F difference to it. You should go put a half on there. Because when I labeled it before, I was just labeling it figuratively. Now I'm labeling it literally, because the frequency of this is at 1/2 the difference. But you hear twice that frequency because you're counting these. You're counting one beat per hertz as one hertz, or one beat per second as one cycle, but that's really 1/2 hertz. Yeah. So anyway, there's that little interesting factor of two that sort of shows up on this kind of stuff. So the last thing about beats is how you can use it with Doppler. So this is very big in medical imaging. So that's why I want you to understand the basics of it. Let's see. It's called, it's also like when you get pulled over, also big in that as well. So Doppler velocimetry. Let's see. So you may wonder, I don't know if you've ever wondered this, but like a radar gun that they use to measure the speed of a car uses radar waves, which are electromagnetic waves, which travel at the speed of light. So it seems kind of weird that you would use something traveling at the speed of light to measure the speed of something traveling at, you know, 90 miles per hour or something. I've never been pulled over for speeding, actually, in my life. I know I have a, it seems to have an obsessive obsession with this. Maybe that's why I haven't been pulled over. It's all I think about. So yeah, it seems like it'd be hard to like have this little thing that can send out a pulse and bounce back and measure like the nanosecond delay to get the speed of the car. And how do you know it's bouncing off the car? Seems weird. Well, that's not how it works. You're going to see why you can use something that goes at the speed of light to measure the speed of an ordinary thing. And what you do is you measure speed through reflection. Through reflection, Doppler shift, and beats. Beats, it's relevant. Look at that. All right. So think of it this way, is that you have two, let's see, so you have your initial wave here gets sent out like that. And it gets sent out, you know, very broadly. All right. And that's going at speed V. So you could do this with sound, you could do this with light, you could do this with any kind of EM radiation. In medical imaging, it's done with ultrasound. So there's a way to bring in ultrasound, not just the image, but how fast things are moving in the image to look at like blood flow and things like that. So you can imagine then, it might bounce and return off of something moving and off of something stationary. So say we had this thing moving at V object, okay? And then we had this one's not moving, okay? So this one, and then I'm sorry, and then the this is gonna be going at frequency F naught, right? So your initial wave's coming on like that. If something's not moving, how's it gonna bounce back? It's going to bounce back at F naught. Right? If you bounce light at one or a wave at one frequency back, it comes back at the same frequency. Haven't proved that to you mathematically, but hopefully you accept that. But since this one is moving, we know there's going to be a Doppler shift, and it's going to come back at a higher frequency. F plus is how we often label it in Doppler problems, right? Higher than F naught. So you could say, okay, well, problem is, if I send in light, say I do this with light, I have like 10 to the 14 hertz here, and surely the Doppler formula is going to increase that by an immeasurable teeny amount, but they're going to interfere, right? These two sources interfere, and then you have, so the superposition of these two things leads to beats that you can measure. And then the beats will be related to how fast the one object is going. So it's okay if you have two really big frequencies that are really close to each other when you get to work with beats. So, and we can go through the math if you want. It's actually a little bit interesting, teeny bit interesting, because let's see, which formula would you use? This seems to be the moving receiver. Oh, but it's also a source. So there's actually a double Doppler going on here. Let's see, what would F plus be? So, you know, this is a little deeper than we went into the Doppler effect, but I think you can understand it, is if you would have one plus V object over V over one minus V object over V times F naught. So this is the formula for, I'm gonna mix them up. One of these is for the case of a moving source, approaching source, and one of these is for the approaching receiver. I think this is source and this is receiver. And you can see that they both act to increase the frequency, right? So this is a small number, much less than one. So one minus this becomes a little slightly less than one. Divide something by a slightly less than one, goes up. One plus this small number, something bigger than one, multiplied by something bigger than one, it goes up. So, and the reason is both effects are happening. You're ascending this frequency in, this thing is moving forward, it hears it as a higher frequency, and then things bounce off and it's acting like a source at an even higher frequency. So all you really have to do is multiply the two effects, one over this and that, if you looked at your Doppler formulas. Okay? And you could combine them in different ways, multiply through by V or something. Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, that's, I think we have a homework on that, I can't remember. But that's the basic idea of how you can use these Doppler shifts to see how things move, but also how beats make it something you can actually observe. Because what would the beat be? F of the beat, which is 1/2, so F of the difference. So what we do sometimes is say the thing you heard, the frequency of that is the beat frequency. It's actually 1/2 of the difference frequency between the two things that are superposing. Right. So the beat frequency was equal to 1/2 of the difference frequency would be 1/2. And what is the difference here? It's we're superposing F plus minus F naught, right? Because this one's coming at you at F plus, this one is F naught. So you're just gonna take the difference of those. So, you know, you could simplify this in some useful formula, okay? Anyway, Doppler velocimetry. You'll see it again in a few minutes. Let's take a mental break here. It's not break time. It's we're about to do a major shift in topic. Everyone's shifting your chair. Let me erase. Be good to have some idea what time it is. I can't see a clock anymore. Okay. Okay, here we go. So the next topic is what's called physical optics. Physical optics. And there's basically three kinds of optics, okay? There's geometrical optics, where we say light is a line, okay? You're gonna do that next week. There is physical optics, where we say light is a wave of the electromagnetic field. And this is what we've been doing up to now. We told you light is a wave. We thought about what happens to the wave when it goes into like glass or water, et cetera. So we've been doing physical optics. But what we're gonna do now is how, since it's a wave, it can also interfere in special important ways. The third kind of optics is quantum optics, which is light is a photon. Okay, and maybe you knew that from chemistry or something, but just because you call light a photon and write a couple of formulas, you're not doing quantum optics. Okay? It's kind of more complicated than that. Okay. So we aren't even going to touch quantum optics. Okay, it's very complicated. There's statistics involved. So physical optics. So there was an early experiment called Young's double slit, and we still use it to this day when we teach interference with light. Partly because it's just ideally set up to explain it, and it was the initial observation that made people say, "Well, that's weird. Why is that happening?" And I can show you a little bit what it looks like. So we're gonna start with this. So we're gonna have a plane wave. Okay, so you gotta accept some of my artwork here. That means a plane wave moving this way. Remember, a plane wave is just the simplest kind of three-dimensional wave. The field is, or whatever, the amplitude is the same as everywhere on a plane like this. And then if you move back half a cycle, it's the other way on a plane like this, back half a cycle, to the way like a plane on this. So when you describe it mathematically, it's really just a 1D wave. It only changes in this dimension and in time. It's constant in these dimensions, all right? So sometimes, just to help you visualize it, I'll draw like a sinusoid like this, implying that, you know, this plane it's positive, this plane it's negative, positive, negative, okay? So I'm going to, in a demo, usually, I was going to show the video of this demo, but it's like so boring and long and not my best work, that I'll just show you a still image from it. There's the plane wave, okay? In this case, the plane wave is just a laser beam, kind of a somewhat big defocused laser beam. And you can think of that as a plane wave, just a little piece of a plane wave, okay? So there's our plane wave. Let's put that away. Is this Young of Young's modulus? Yes, he was a polymath. So if you ever hear like the same name on two or three things from 200 or 300 years ago, same person. There weren't that many people. Okay. For one reason, there weren't that many people. And it was easy to discover new stuff back then, you know. Okay, same Young, Thomas Young. Was he a jerk? Do I have stories about Young? I don't remember. He lived a really long time. That's the... So we have our plane wave, and now what Young did, or maybe other people, of course, saw it, and he explained it. That might be. I usually know these historical stories, but I'm starting to slip. Okay, double slit. This is why it's called Young's double slit. These are little opaque barriers here, and the plane wave approaches them. And you know, the plane wave is the same everywhere, like this. Oops, like that. So it's approaching. And what happens when the plane wave goes through the slits? The question is, what are you going to get on a screen? If you cast it upon a screen, what pattern are you going to get? So, you know, without the slits, you just get even illumination. With the slits, you know, like Aristotle or somebody, what is it? Oh, you get this, right? Well, that must be what you get, right? Plato, one of those Euclid people. But no, that's not what you get. You get something that looks like this. Ooh, look at that. You get a pattern of bright and dark and bright and dark. Really weird, really unexpected. And you can say why. And the reason is because light is a wave and it propagates as a wave. We got to bring in one other weird idea, not just 1D interference. Okay, but we'll get there. Okay, well, I'll tell you the idea now, then we'll start doing the math. Okay, so the idea is when this plane wave hits a little narrow thing like this, it becomes a point source of light. And that point source of light then spreads out as a spherical wave, or in this case, a hemispherical wave, because it can't go back through the, well, whatever, it doesn't go back, don't worry about it. And this is that pattern we looked at when we did sort of 2D, whatever, 2D propagation and interference. Yeah, we thought about this a little bit when we did sound. So that's the one big thing you got to realize: in the slit, becomes a point source, does this, and then these things interfere in a complicated way that leads to an intensity that looks like this. Which you can, well, that's not real space, right? Which looks like that. And that's what you're seeing here. You're just seeing the intensity go up and down, up and down. Why does it drift off to zero? We'll get to that later, okay? But basically it's going up and down, up and down, up and down, okay? And the reason is, now here's the 1D interference we can do, is we can say, what is it here at this point on the screen? You just draw one R there, and you draw another R there, and you just do 1D interference. So it's spreading out as a spherical wave, but if you have two points and you need to go from one place to the other, you can call that spherical wave just a 1D wave along that direction. And then it's easier, makes the problems easier. Okay, so let's do a few bullets so when you read this later, you'll know what the heck's going on. The slits turn plane wave into two-point source spherical waves, hemispherical, really. Like that, okay. And what else were we? So another interesting thing about this is that they are in phase. In phase. And what we mean by that is that their phase constants are going to be equal. So since this plane wave was just a nice coherent sinusoid, it hits the two point sources at the same time. So they're oscillating in phase. So you don't have to worry about some weird phase constant difference. That's another great thing about Young's double slit. Now in 1800 whatever, to make a plane wave, they had to have a light source hit another slit. So there's actually three slits in Young's double slit. But since it's 20 something and we have coherent light, I don't draw that anymore. If you see this in your book with three slits, they're not trying to like be extra. It's that you used to have three slits. And then the waves interfere at the screen. And you would think you're gonna have to draw this horrible pattern, but really you don't. All you gotta do is for any point on the screen is go to the phase difference. That's what tells us what's happening with interference. Remember, there's the phase, the thing inside the sinusoid. There's the phase constant, the constant at the end, that's a constant, tells you where zero is. And then there's the phase difference. This is the one when there's two waves that you are superposing. Someone asked, is that why you can hear sound around corners? Yes, basically. So when the objects blocking and unblocking the wave get down to even close to the wavelength of the wave, waves bend around them, right? So these slits are usually really narrow. If you have really wide slits, like, you know, 10 centimeters wide, you would just get a picture of the two slits. So we're talking slits that they don't have to be down to the wavelength of light, but they have to be, you know, 10 times the wavelength of the light to see it. The bending even happens around the big slits. It's just so small in the pattern you don't notice it. I can show it to you if we hang out for a week sometime. I can't, I'm trying to think how I could show it to you here on, I have a laser. No, okay, not going to do it. Not live. I'll try to figure out a way. So this phase difference formula is going to be the same as it always is, right? How many fractions of a wavelength turned into radians are the two things different, right? The path difference, how many wavelengths is that path difference? Is it a half wavelength leading to destructive? Is it a full wavelength leading to constructive? And then plus the delta phi naught, right? And then that, if you want it to be constructive, for constructive. We could calculate the destructives too, but we're probably just going to calculate constructive. And hey, look, we know this is zero, right? Because we said the phase constants will be the same. I don't know why I put deltas on that. That doesn't need to have deltas on it. Those are just the phase constants. Yeah. Okay, so the change in phase constants are the same, right? Yeah. So the change is zero. So really, then this is all we have to deal with. We just have to think about how are those two R's different? And what pattern will it create? And this is the reason the pattern is interesting, is because you can imagine the difference between these two R's as you move up and down the screen is all wild. Yeah. Okay, so what we're gonna do now is erase it and draw it again. Because I need all this junk. We gotta have a clean drawing of it. So here we go. So let me erase. We'll redraw Young's little slit. Because, you know, we're gonna get into the geometry a bit. But in the end, if you just understand the final formula and how it depends on everything, that's good enough. But we need to go through the geometry once carefully to make sure everyone is getting their money's worth here. We really need a clock. Okay, so let's think about a double slit. I can't write slit. Double slit, spacing of D. Right, we have to start putting, you know, numbers on these things. That says spacing, I don't know. I can't write it. Spacing of D and distance L. And that distance will be clear what that means when I draw it. That's to the screen. Okay, so let's see. So here is our slits again. Here are our slits, And the spacing D is like that. All right, so I'm not gonna draw the plane move. I'm trying to label things here. And then the screen is over here. And there it is. I like to give it a width because it's a physical object. It deserves a width. And that's what L is. When I say the distance, I mean the distance to the screen. All right. What we're gonna do is see if we can plot the intensity along the screen like that. Plot the intensity along the screen. And here's the key. As you move along the screen, delta R changes. So we just have to figure out a mathematical way to get delta R. So let's say we want to know what's going on here. So we say, okay, we draw that there. That we'll call R1. And we draw that there. We'll call that R2. Okay, so there's our two lines. Let's see. So let's see, what is delta R? So what we gotta do is draw like a triangle somewhere. That's always the key. So let's draw a triangle by drawing a line perpendicular. Where's that gonna be? About right there. Oh my God. I can draw long straight lines. I can't draw short straight lines. Okay, so there. There's a line from this one, R1 to R2, with a right angle there. Okay. So where then is delta R? It's right there. Right? Delta R literally just means the length of R2 minus the length of R1. And don't think of it as vectors. We're not doing vectors. We're doing kind of like they're 1D. Okay. So now we need a formula for delta R. Well, so now we get into our approximations. I could just tell you the answer. You'd probably accept it. You might not even notice the approximations. And I could sneak several things past you. Or I could describe all the approximations and everybody will get confused. Or we could go half and do halfway and then literally everyone will be confused. Let's do that. Let's see. So we need to come up with some triangle work here, some trigonometry on this triangle. So what we're going to say is that the angle, so the triangle is kind of like this. So you can see it, this middle wall is in the way here. There's the triangle. Let's see. It doesn't look good anymore. And there, that's the angle we care about. I know you can't see that, that theta. That theta is the same as this theta. Okay, if we drew just a straight line from the two rays, that would be theta. I could draw it here too, also theta, okay? Now clearly, these two thetas aren't the same, okay? But this answer we're getting is for L is much greater than D. So that's our first approximation, okay? Assume L is much greater than D, so all thetas are the same. That's one. So the screen is far away. Slits are like less than a millimeter apart. The screen is like 10 meters away. So that's why if I were to stretch this to that ridiculous degree, these two lines would look parallel. It would look like just two lines right on top of each other going away. So that's why those two angles are roughly the same. And we could do a little bit of trig. I could draw another line there and do two triangles and do 90 minus must be that angle, which 90 minus that. And I could definitely show you that that equals that. We don't want to do that in geometry. And also, but you can imagine if we stretch this out as these angles go down, this angle goes down, this angle goes down, that angle also goes down. So those are similar angles or equal angles, okay? So we have that angle. We did some approximate geometry. And now we just need to know delta R. So now we have the delta R, and now we just do a little trig because we know an angle and we know this side of the triangle. Right? That side of the triangle is D. So this side, delta R, is just D sine theta. Sine is opposite over the hypotenuse. The hypotenuse is D. So delta R is D sine theta. And that's it. All those approximations can be done formally if you like. You know, we could do a Taylor expansion and all this stuff. I'm just trying to get you there without all that work. All right. So let's put that in our phase. Put in the phase difference, which we know is delta phi is delta R d sine theta over lambda times 2 pi. But we know that there's no phase constant difference. So we already said that one was zero. So we just need to set that equal to 2 pi m for constructive. Because we just care about the maximum right now. Where m, you know, equals 0, 1, 2, blah, blah, blah. So where are the maxima going to be? Well, let's see. And count them to go away, right? And then I could write it like this, d sine theta equals m lambda. That is how it's usually written. Now, does that tell you where the maxima are? Like, I don't see y in there, right? But it's in the theta. It's in the sine theta. Right? So these are the maxima. Sine theta is like a weird way to plot it, though. Why would we plot it versus sine theta? Let's check the one place where we know it's a maximum. What is the, think for a second, where's the one place on the screen where you are absolutely certain that this thing is a maximum? Right, oh wait, I can use the screen. There, right in the middle, right? Because if you go right in the middle, what if the R1, R2 are basically symmetric. So they're the same length. So that's the case where R, what delta R is zero. All right, so, or you could say, what is the case where we have m equals zero here? That's the maximum where sine theta equals zero. Where is sine theta zero? At theta equals zero, right? Which is also straight across. So this formula you use to solve problems when you're thinking in terms of sine theta does at least confirm that we would get a maximum, you know, there. At zero. And also, since it's a sine, it does actually also confirm that you're going to get something oscillating like that. Okay. But that's in terms of sine theta. Also, if you want to get it in terms of just theta, you could take an inverse sine. There, now you have a formula for theta. But there's another way we do it. And what we're going to do now is we're going to keep our drawing, but put new formulas. Oh, of course, I plotted it on the wrong side. That's fine. Let's see, what else can we do with this? Because you might be asked questions about, like, what's the spacing between the two maxima? Obviously, I didn't do that. So what is the, how far apart are they? Let's see. So what we really want to be able to do is describe the intensity versus y. So we say along the screen, is y, and this, maybe I will plot the intensity on this side this time. Okay, I'm gonna plot the intensity versus this height along the column. So we have to do another approximation technically to say this. If L is also much greater than y, okay? So we're saying it's really far and it's only up just a teeny bit, then sine theta is y over l, right? Now, why is that an approximation? Sine theta is always y over l, right? So we got this triangle like this, right? And sine theta opposite over hypotenuse, opposite's y. This is l. It's really tangent theta is y over l. But for really, really low angles, sine and tangent are the same. Yeah, because tangent sine over cosine. And for really low angles, cosine is basically one. Right. So all we're really saying then is that sine and tangent are the same. Okay. Or just don't worry about all that and just say y over the hypotenuse is basically the same as y over l. So that's what sine is. If that's true, then you just plug that into our little formula. Instead of writing down d sine theta, you say d y over l equals m times lambda is where the maxima are. Or you write it in sort of the more standard way that you'll see in your book, y max, which means the positions of the maxima, are equal to m lambda l over d. Or sometimes you put the m outside just to make it clear, that's the index. And so the m is the thing that's going 0, 1, 2, 3, actually also negative 1, negative 2, negative 3. These are all properties of the physical setup. Right? That's how you tell where they are. Okay, let's see. So what does that tell us then? Well, let's just look at it. Does it predict that there will be something in the middle of the screen or along, if we call, to do this, we have to say the origin is here. So it does put it in a maximum at the origin, right? Because that's m equals zero. And then it says, this tells you how high you have to go to get to the next maximum. M equals one, and how low you would have to go to get to the next maximum, m equals minus one, right? And you don't have the math yet, but it also does this, right? It goes like that. And if you did another one, like we saw in that picture, the next one over would be m equals two, and the next one would be m equals three, and then going down, m equals minus two. So these tell you where the peaks appear on the screen. Okay, the sine theta formula did also. It's just this is more of a direct thing. So we don't use tangent because there's a sine in the other formula we derived. Remember? So our main formula was d sine theta equals n lambda. Why did that have a sine? Because of this. So this originally gave us sine. So that's what we have to approximate it into a sine rather than calling it a tangent. There's 100 mathematical ways you can get there. Probably other, like, call this a tangent by approximation if you wanted to. Okay. So the last thing to do on Young's double slit. Oh, we're way over. Let me tell you the last two things about Young double slit. And then we'll take our break and do little films here. Two little things then. Well, one is to get, let's get an intuition for why, what these different m's mean. It's worth it, right? So say we go up and we have like a source here and a source here and we're looking right there, right? It looks like that. If you draw that line, here's your little extra. Right, this is the delta r. M equals one means one wave fits in the delta r. Because if they start out together and this one has to go through one wave and then they get to the same length, they're going to remain together. And that's going to be a maximum. So then you can say, well, what is m equals two? M equals two happens higher, like up here. And then somehow I didn't draw it well, so it looks the same. I didn't draw them far enough apart, right? So there we go. That's the same distance apart. Let's go a lot higher, like that, see, now it's longer, it's supposed to be twice as long, but it puts two waves in there. And then, so that's n equals two. What about n equals zero? Could have drawn that one first. Right, there's no waves, right? There's no distance, no distance between them, same length. So that's the idea, is as you go up and down, you're making this thing longer and shorter, and you hit maxima when you can fit a full wave in there. Then two little minor things, that's the intuition behind it, is the minima are between the maxima, evenly spaced. So, you know, we don't really do formulas and talk about the where the minima are, but if you're asked where a minimum was in a problem, it's just find the two maxima on either side, and it's right in the middle. You can write a formula for it too if you want. And then the intensity. So in this class, we aren't spending a lot of time going from the amplitudes of waves to intensities of waves. There's a different formula for each kind of wave. But here I'm just going to give you the intensity that we might use somewhere. I, and I'll tell you what all the parts mean, equals 4i naught cosine squared. Okay, so the intensity equals 4 times the incident intensity cosine squared pi d over lambda l y. Okay, what that is the complete formula for this thing. All right, a cosine squared, so we knew it was going to be like a sinusoidal function because it's got high low. Intensity can't be negative because it's energy, so that's why it has to be squared. And just for the mathematical setup we do with these two things with the zero directly between them, it's described as a cosine squared. So if you were to find the maxima of this, it is the two simple formulas we just did. That's where the maxima are. But this is, if you did a little bit more, you got the actual shape of this curve, it's a cosine squared. This, and by intensity, we mean watts per meter squared. This is incident on the screen, okay? And then that's 4, yeah. So everything else you've been told. Okay. So anyway, I just want you to have that intensity function. I don't remember how much we use it, but it's derived in the book if you want to go through the derivation, but it's not really necessary. The main thing is the idea of why there's interference. Okay, so homeworks on this, you know, aren't gonna be too wild. You could have slits that you magically separate. How does the pattern change? You could have a set of slits and you put on one color, one frequency, you have one spacing. What will the spacing be for a different frequency? So from that first frequency, you could maybe get the D, and then apply the D to the second frequency, right? You actually could, think about it, is I could pick a random spot and say, what's the phase difference here? You could do it, you just there, delta R, use the phase difference formula. Delta phi equals, you know. So if we asked for what's the phase difference, that means the delta R over lambda times 2 pi. That's the phase difference in radians. So I think you're good to go with Young's double slit. Now you may have noticed if you're looking closely.
So what we're gonna do is
No, that's not it. Somewhere I have another picture. I'll get to it later. Okay, so it's time for the break. 5 minute break, dangerous demo to watch, break. Here we go, so I'll see you in 5 minutes.
So what we're gonna do is I'm gonna be like the fast moving object with the source, okay? So we're gonna have the frequency of this thing will be 800 hertz. So we're gonna crank 800 hertz out of here. And I may have them in phase or out of phase. Yeah, let's see. There we go, in phase, okay. And we're listening to it over here, right? So I'm gonna start recording over here. There's a speaker in here. I only want to hear the sound direct. I don't want to hear it bouncing all over the place. So the speaker's in a box, right? And the frequency of the speakers, one is at 800 hertz, but the other one is going to be moving, and it's going to be what you learned last semester, F naught over 1 minus V over VS, VS, the source speed over V. So 800 over 1 minus however fast I can go over 343. I can't go very fast compared to 343. So this is going to be like 800 and 802. This will be 800. This will only get up to 802. It's hard to hear the difference between 800 and 802, but it's easy to hear the beats, right? So all we got to do is record it and play it and see if we can hear the beats. All right, here we go. 2 minutes, plenty of time. Okay, here we go. Go as fast as I can. Oh, this needs to be over here a little bit. This needs to be there, like that. All right, you ready? All right, here we go. Okay, let's listen to it now. Let's listen to it and see if we can hear the beats when I grabbed it and moved it. I was the moving object. Here we go. Here's me yelling. Okay, let's get it. Did you hear it? Right at the end, it went wah, wah. That was it, right at the end. Whoa, whoa. Okay, so I'm going to make that into the homework problem.
Okay. So we made it through your unacceptable slit, and that was one example of interference. And we really are just going to do two. We're going to do Young's double slit, and we're going to do thin films. There's many other places interference shows up in the world and important physics instruments, but we got to get going. So let's talk about thin films, and then Thursday we'll do diffraction, but I'll try to work in some problems. I didn't really have any problems ready to do, but I promise you we will do some practice problems Thursday. And then the third homework set I put out has, you know, has this stuff in it as well. So. But let's just barrel through another phenomenon, and then we'll get to problems later. Okay. The next kind of interference in, and these are called thin dielectric films. All right. So like bubbles are the most famous case, or the little films on your glasses to reduce reflections. Like when you look at your glasses and they're kind of blue and red or kind of green and yellow. These are thin dielectric films. Okay, so but first we have to review a few things about light. Light in and on a dielectric. What happens? A dielectric in. Remember, n is the index of refraction. So for a glass, it's 1.5, etc. And we talked about what that does to the light. One, it slows to C over N. Remember, the light goes slower in glass. Speed of light divided by N. It squishes the wavelength, drops to lambda not over N. Those two things we already talked about. Here's new stuff. It is partially reflects at a dielectric interface. We'll be drawing a bunch of these in a minute. All it means is you go from one dielectric to another. So if your light going through glass, I'm sorry, your light going through air, it suddenly hits a glass surface, that glass surface is a dielectric interface. The index went from 1 to 1.5. Okay, we'll be drawing that, but that's what that means. So partially reflects at a dielectric interface. Gets a pi phase shift. Pi phase shift. A pi phase shift when reflected from higher index. So if the light is moving along in air, index of one, and it hits glass, the light that reflects back will be pi phase shift. But you can also have reflections at an internal index. Light can be moving along in glass, hit an opening to the air, some of it will reflect back into the glass, but with no pi phase shift. Okay, it's only from a higher index. Those are just rules, okay? I'll go ahead and put it. Zero phase shift, just in case you're wondering later, when reflected from lower index. Okay, those are the rules. All right, so I think I've left myself room to draw a soap film if I crowd things in. Because, you know, we all know that soap has these interesting, beautiful properties. I have a video to show you this. Let me show it to you. And we're going to do a new thing. I decided, you know, I gotta be hip, and I gotta do what the kids are doing, you know? I gotta do a reaction video. That's what I'm trying to say. Let's watch a reaction here to the Gazillion Bubble Show. Here we go. I'm excited. Let's see what's gonna be. We've got a galaxy and stars and lens flare. I'm already confused. Oh, protein structure. No, wait. Oh, no, it's just the logo. The Gazillion Bubble Show. What does it proudly presents? It looks like... Oh, Fan Yang. Oh, look at that bubble. That's not a bubble, that's smoke. Oh, it's a world tour. There it is. That's what I wanted to show you there. Look at that bubble. Look at the colors. Look at the bands. Look at the colors and bands. Oh, the passion. Wait, those are smoke rings. Those aren't bubbles. How's that? Okay, whatever. Let's go back to what I wanted to show you there. Here it is. Wait, where did it go? Yes. Right here. All these colors at different angles. But what is going on with these bands? Look at that. Red, black, red, black, red, black, blue, purple, black. So maybe you've seen these kind of structures in silk films before. That's this other one, I think. Okay, we're working it. Oh, the passion. So here you can see all these colors showing up here. That's sort of a George O'Keefe thing going on. That's not related to the bubbles. But here you see those bands again. Blue, green, blue, green, blue, green. So let's see if we can ruin the beauty of this with physics. I am quite confident that I can. Okay, so let's see here. So what it's all related to is a soap film. So let's draw one here. Let's draw the physical thing that's gonna happen when light hits this soap film. Okay, I'm gonna draw it kind of thick. So we're going microscopic here. It's got a thickness T. Okay, it has index N. That's the properties of our soap film. And we're gonna have light come in. Now, you can see through a soap film, right? So most of the light is just gonna go right through the soap film and nothing is gonna happen, okay? But we said one rule, well, one rule is that it's supposed to squish up. I'm not gonna draw it squishing up. I'm not gonna draw the wavelength getting shorter because I'm just too tired. But another rule was that we get these reflections. So you'll get a reflection right there, okay? Coming back at you. It'll obey the laws of reflection, which I didn't draw well, don't worry about that. That's not what we're talking about. Let's call that R1, or just call it one, right? That's coming back at you, but you also get a reflection from this dielectric interface. And that's two coming back at you, right? So the reason bubbles have interesting colors, is that a bracket? Okay, is interference between front and back reflections. Okay, let's see how much time did we waste in our reaction video? Oh, we got a lot of time. All right. So this is the new interference problem we're solving. And just for your notes later, and then this is three. So one, reflect off the front surface. I think it's clear in the diagram, but people have told me these diagrams are very confusing. Two is reflect off the back surface, right? And then three is just transmitted. Okay. Now, I know how smart you are. Yes, some will reflect here. It'll go on forever. But if you actually knew the physics that tells you the amplitudes of these things, you'd find that this is about 4%, this is about 4%, this is about 92%, and then everything else is going to be teeny. That's just the way the numbers work out. We don't have time to go into it. If you bring in 100%, you'll get about 4% of the intensity in each one of these, and then 92 will go through. And you see these reflections, you know, if this is like when you have a clear piece of glass and you look at yourself in it, you mostly see what's coming behind, but you can see yourself in a clear piece of glass. You can see yourself in it. Or if you look at yourself on the reflection of water, right? That's so these reflections do happen. Okay, so the physics problem we have to do is the interference between one and two. All right, it's not that much, because especially now you've done it. I mean, it's very similar to a double slit. I'm just gonna figure out what's the path difference. Let's see. All right. Okay, so I'm gonna draw it again without all the wiggly lines here. This again, we have a thickness T, we have index M, we have the light. Some of it goes straight through, some bounces there, some bounces there. So this is one, and this is two. Going that way, that goes that way. And these are the class, okay. Okay, so here's some things we're gonna assume here. I'm drawing this as though the light is coming in at an angle. Assume light comes in perpendicular to the surface. Okay. It can be calculated for angles relative to the surface. That's the reason for all the beautiful changing colors. We'll just do normal light, which will also involve beautiful changing colors, okay? So in that case, then let's write the phase difference. We know it's always delta R over lambda times 2 pi plus delta phi naught. All right. So let's look at this and say, what do we know? What is delta R? It's the difference in the path length of this and this. And keep in mind, we're really doing it for like no angle. So the path difference is 2t. One of them goes an extra in and back. Oh my God, I'm missing the index. Did I drive this whole thing without the index? I didn't write the index in here. And I don't have a physical thing to say to you to explain. I don't have a plan. Okay. Okay, how much further to go? 2t, and the index has to go there over lambda times 2 pi. Let's just go with that for now. I don't know how I didn't write the n and didn't notice. Okay. Anyway, so I'll explain why the n is there later. Plus, what is the difference in the phase constant? It's zero, because it's the same wave, right? It's a wave coming in. It only has one phase constant, and when it breaks up here, it's got the same phase constant. Okay, so that is zero. But is that the end of the story? Is there any other way that we could have a change up in phase here? And there is, because of the reflections. It picks up a pi phase shift on reflection. So we need another term here plus delta phi r, which is basically which one, what's the difference in how many pi phase shifts they picked up? That's the question. So what is that gonna be? Well, we're doing one minus two, or two minus one, right? Here, this delta r became this 2tm. And somebody asked what 2t is. It's like, literally, it's the distance. This one went t and then back t, right? That's the reason that has to be in there. And why is the n there? So I don't have like a drawing. I didn't plan ahead how to explain it. But remember, the wavelength changes. So you're really counting waves in here. And you're comparing it to the vacuum wavelength. So that's why you have to have that index n there. I'll come up with a nice drawing for that next time. It's just, one isn't coming to me off the top of my head right now. I guess you could think of it this way, is that what's really here, it's really like how many wavelengths does it go through? And this lambda is lambda naught over n. I think that's the way you usually think about it. That's why there's an n there. But the 2t is because that's the physical path difference. Right, the path length for R1 is zero, right? It just is here, it's immediately out. This one has to go through two T's to get out. But that means if we go now to delta R, we're gonna look at the reflection pi phase shifts of two minus the reflection pi phase shifts of one. Okay, how many reflection pi phase shifts Is that, this n is multiplying, t times n, yeah. How many pi phase shifts did two go through? Ray two go through? Here it went into the glass, no pi phase shift. Here it reflected off the back, but that's from high index to low index, right? This is glass, this is water or something, and this is equal to one, right? So we're high to low. So there's no pi phase shift there. Phi is actually a Greek letter, so it's messed up. So this one we'll say is zero on the pi phase shifts. One does have a pi phase shift, right? Because right there, it bounces off a higher index. So over here, then we say, okay, let's write it out explicitly, zero minus pi, okay? So you do have a constant pi in here, a constant phase shift, but it's actually not like the phase constant. It's because of the reflections. So to be real specific about that, we actually add a new term we call delta phi reflections. That's how I do it. I forget if the book does it exactly like that or not. Still can't believe I didn't write an N in there. Okay, so let's look at this now and say, what is this? This is 4TN over lambda naught times 2 pi minus pi equals, now we're trying to make this equal. And what are we looking for? Right, we're looking for constructive interference. Where is this going to be bright? Equals 2 pi m constructive. We could look for a destructive too, but it's just in between the constructive. Okay. See, look at that. And oh, the pi's can go all the way. And that minus 1 there becomes a plus 1 over there. So it becomes 2m plus 1. And oh, already 2 times 2 was 4. I already did that. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, so in the end, you have 4tn over lambda naught equals 2m plus 1, where m equals, you know, 0, 1, 2, standard thing for constructive. Okay, so that would be our condition for constructive interference. What we want to do then is work on our physical insight. What does it mean? Okay, so I'll just redraw it over here real quick and say, what does it mean? So for the bubble, these are just property, these are where the maxima happen. And you could say, well, for what? How do I use this? So we could say there's a certain wavelength of soap, which is n equals 1.33, what thickness will give you a strong reflection? So you could solve for the thickness. Or you could say white light is being shined on a soap film of a certain thickness and n, what wavelengths are bright? I'll put in 1, 0, 1, 2, 3 and get the different lambdas. Because this formula is useful for finding thicknesses and wavelengths for different orders of constructive interference. So the order part is what I mean there. Is want to think about, what if this wave, what would m equals zero correspond to? So a wave comes in, draw myself a little more room. Let's draw m equals zero. A wave comes in and it's making like a wave like this. It's coming in like that. And when it goes in, m equals zero is the case where you go through a quarter cycle there, and then, let's just keep drawing this straight line. It goes through, it finishes that quarter, another quarter cycle, finishes a half cycle, and it comes out, hold on, let's see. It goes in, oh, I'm sorry, I made it go negative, right? Yeah. It's high, it bounces down, and it comes out like net down. What does this reflection do along here? Well, it's should go up, but it's a pi phase shift, so it also goes down. So you can see that's constructive. Mm-hmm. I know this is hard. Yeah. What if we did n equals 1? So n equals 1 now. It's really, what I'm trying to say is it's really just how many waves are you cramming into the film? For m equals 0, you're cramming just a half wave into the film, right? But what if we went even higher, like this? So it goes up, up, and then we're cramming a little bit more. Oh my God. And then it comes out down. And this should go up and it reflects pi phase shift, comes out down. So as you go to higher M, all you're doing is fitting more and more waves inside the film. Just like with Young's double slit, you're fitting more and more waves in the little delta R between the two slits. That's all the different in orders mean.
Okay.
And then finally, the reason you were seeing those bands in the soap is if you take a soap film and you let it rest, molecule or the water builds up at the bottom. This is what a soap film really looks like. If you just let it sit, gravity makes it collect at the bottom and you get a difference in thickness. So you have like a region that's M equals zero. And then you have a region that holds M equals one. And then you have a region like this. So these are your constructive, right? So if you send a certain wavelength in, you know, this is constructive and this is constructive and this is constructive. And in between it's less constructive or destructive. So that's why you see those bands in a soap film. And then the reason you see all the colors in the soap film is the difference in the thicknesses. They do this when it's like sitting with gravity, but when it's just soap swirling around in a bubble in a sphere, you see all the colors. And then finally, you also see colors, which we're not doing, but when you look at different angles, when you look at a different angle, you're effectively looking through a thicker film. So it also depends, the wavelength depends on angle. Okay. So I'll show you how we use this and these ideas with some problems Thursday. But that's all we got for now. All right, so see you Thursday. Two M plus one, it was just our standard two pi M, and this pi here from the reflection term, when I divided by pi turned into a negative one, and I just took it to the other side. So that has no physical, two M one doesn't mean anything physical, it's just what the math turned M into.